Welcome to the most exciting video that you are ever going to watch. Yes, it is. And what will we be covering, you ask? Sports cars? Explosions? The top 10 most dangerous bees? Even better, file organization. Oh yes, friends, buckle up because this is going to be one wild ride. Especially since I have access to all this explosion footage, which I'm going to apply liberally throughout this video. Now, I should say that this is one half of a wild ride because there are in fact two halves to your file system. The files that exist in your computer and the ones that exist here in the real world. And if you're anything like me, most of your files exist digitally, and we're gonna cover exactly how to organize them in the next video in this series. But due to my very intense study on game design principles, I have learned that it is best to start off with the easier stuff. So today we're gonna focus on your physical file system. Now, my personal physical file system is pretty small, and that is because whenever I get a piece of paper, my first instinct is to either recycle it immediately or digitize it, and then of course, recycle it. And later on in this video, we're gonna talk all about digitization and how to do it easily. But sometimes you're gonna have physical files that you just need to keep for one reason or another. Perhaps it's your birth certificate, or your passport, or a clipping of a newspaper article that mentioned you back in the 8th grade. Gotta keep that for posterity's sake. Whatever it is time to organize it. So when it comes to storing physical files, I use a simple system that consists of 3 locations. The main file box, the inbox, and a portable file folder. The main file box is the place where the majority of your physical files should eventually end up if you're not going to digitize them. And if you have a lot of papers you need to store, you could buy a multi-drawer filing cabinet for this purpose. However, I find that a single file box is more than enough for me. And this is what it looks like, and now you know why the continuity error was there. Now, this file box, and pretty much every single other one like it, is built to store hanging folders, each of which gets a label, and that's how you can easily see what's in them. Now, when you're creating your structure here, I think it's a good idea to try to adhere to a tree structure, where you have a top level of organization, which is essentially your root, and then from which you can create multiple deeper sublevels, or branches. And personally, I use these hanging file folders as the top level of my organization system. I don't really have a whole lot of files, so that's really all I need. Though there are ways that you could go deeper if you need to. The first is to simply put multiple regular folders within your hanging folders. And I actually do have an example of this, because my landlord left this entire file box with the house that I'm renting because she is supremely organized, and honestly, she should be making this video instead of me. But within her box, each hanging file folder is actually just a repository for multiple regular folders. And each of these folders in here is a place to store all the manuals and instructions for all kinds of stuff in the house. So we have things like the air conditioner, the dryer, the hose reel. Now, if you don't wanna use the folders within folders method, because you don't wanna buy tons of folders or you don't want them to take up so much space, there are other methods, such as using a piece of printer paper as a divider between different sections within your hanging folders. And to make sure that you can easily thumb through and see where your dividers are, you can use these little sticky flags. I often use these for taking notes in books and making sure that I can see which page I took a note on. But if you just take one of these off of here and then sort of, you know, stick it right on your piece of paper, then that sticks up and you can put that into your file folders and be easily able to thumb through them. And if you wanted to, you could use construction paper instead of normal printer paper, so it's a little bit, you know, different feeling from the rest of the documents, but either way is pretty easy. Now, aside from the ones I just mentioned, there are other methods, such as the one that you can see in this picture, where they're actually using the colors of the folder labels as an even higher level of organization. But let's move on to the next location in the system, the icebox. Wait, that's not right, the inbox. So be honest with me here. When you get a piece of mail that needs to go into your file box, how often do you immediately open up that file box and put it in the correct spot? I'd wager a guess that it's not 100% of the time and that your kitchen table is often used as a convenient place to toss things that will get dealt with later. Here's the thing. The first part of that is fine, and you probably shouldn't be opening up your file box and finding the exact folder every single time you need a file at the exact moment you get it. It's a lot more efficient to have a specific time blocked out for processing all of your unorganized files, mail, and of course, cryptic messages nailed to your door written in cutout magazine letters. But your kitchen table does not deserve to be a dumping ground for all these things in the meantime. because that is a job for your inbox. So an inbox is a simple tray or a stack of trays if you really want to get fancy that sits on your desk. And whenever you get something that needs to be processed later on, you put it in the inbox. And then at least once a week, you want to go through everything that's in this inbox and decide what needs to be done with it. If it represents a task like paying water bill, then you want to deal with it. Otherwise, you might want to digitize it or recycle it or put it in your main file box. Pretty simple. And that brings us to the final piece of your physical file organization puzzle, which is the one that travels with you. So when you're out of the house and you're away from your file box and your inbox, you still need some way to store any papers you get from work or class, and of course from the guy outside your local coffee shop holding his "the end is nigh" sign. He's got some pretty interesting pamphlets and you should probably take one. Now, depending on the type of work you do and the classes you attend, your portable file folder can function either as a portable inbox, which you want to clear on a regular basis, or as a mini file box that actually holds papers for a significant amount of time. Now, if you are anything like me, then you probably don't have any physical papers that you need to carry with you. You might have like a physical notebook or be carrying a novel, but you're not actually carrying worksheets or other papers that you actually need to use on a regular basis. And if that's the case, then I recommend just keeping a single folder in your bag. This gives you a safe place to temporarily store any papers that you get while you're out and about, and it doesn't take up a whole lot of space at all. And then when you get home each day, you can move any papers and end of the world pamphlets that you've received on all of your adventures to either your inbox for later processing or into your main file system if you have a decent amount of time. But what if you're a student who needs to carry around assignments and handouts? Or what if you're a high-powered, slick-haired business person who needs to carry around, well, you know, your business papers? If this is the case, then I think a single file folder probably isn't going to cut the mustard. Actually, hang on a second.
Anna, do we have any mustard?
Yes.
Get, where's the mustard?
Why?
Science.
Okay. You're worrying me a little bit.
That's enough.
Okay. Oh my God. Okay, I stand corrected. The edge of a folder is more than capable of cutting mustard, but you still shouldn't use it. Instead, you wanna look into getting a portable accordion folder. These give you several folders in one slim, compact package, which means that they act as a portable file box you can actually work out of. And you can easily separate and organize all the different papers for your classes or very important business deals. And unlike old school binders with a hard spine, these expand or contract based on how much you're carrying. Now, before we move on, I wanna briefly mention a couple of other locations that you may wanna add to your file system. The first is what I call a manuals box. And for me, this is just a regular old cardboard box I put things like my piano manual or my TV manual, because I don't like keeping these things in my main file box since they're bulky, but there really aren't enough of them to warrant a whole new folder system. Which brings me to a point that I wanted to mention here. Sometimes over-optimizing one tiny part of your life ends up taking so much time that you kind of de-optimize your life as a whole. So sometimes letting something be a little bit messy or a little bit, you know, unorganized is fine because it really doesn't matter in the long run. So that being said, the second one that I want to mention here is a safety deposit box. You can rent these at banks, and they can be a safe place to keep things like the original copy of your birth certificate, or your passport, and the rest of your John Wick coins. Now, I don't use one of these since I can just store all of my John Wick coins under the concrete floor of my basement, and because, well, they cost money. But I do want to mention them because I know a lot of my viewers live in dorms and apartments with roommates who don't always take even simple security matters, like not leaving the front door wide open, seriously. So you can consider it. All right, to round out this guide, I want to talk about something that's even better than properly storing and organizing your paper files, namely digitizing them. That's right, it's time to start adopting the mostly paperless lifestyle. So digitization is the process of scanning your physical files and turning them into electronic images or PDFs. And then from there, you can easily slot them into your beautifully constructed computer folder system where they no longer take up any space in your home or backpack, but more importantly, are backed up and no longer vulnerable to fires, bullies, or the random escaped zoo gorilla. Personally, I try to digitize almost every paper I get because it takes very little time to do so. And this is especially true now that almost everyone has an ultra high resolution camera built into their phone. Now, in the past, the only ways to digitize papers were either to go buy a scanner or go down to FedEx, Kinko's, or Staples and scan documents there. But now you can just use your phone, which means that you can digitize handouts and receipts and other papers literally wherever you are. And additionally, if you're using the right app, you can also automatically send your scans into your file system with no manual choosing of folders. So here is how I digitize my files. And the first thing that I want to mention is that for the most part, I send my scans into my Evernote account instead of my computer's main file system. Why, you might ask? Well, all of my article research, my book notes, my recipes, journal entries, and almost every other idea that I have goes in to Evernote. So that's why I choose to send scans there as well. But there is one other reason. Evernote makes your scans searchable, even if they're images. Now, I tend to upload my scans as PDFs because I often stitch lots of things together into like a multi-page document, but you can also add pictures into Evernote, and its optical character recognition algorithm will allow you to search any text in them, even if it's handwriting. That being said, I don't actually use Evernote's built-in scanning tool to do this. Instead, I use an app called ScanBot. I found that ScanBot's ability to quickly detect the edges of a piece of paper or a business card or receipt or literally whatever it is that I'm scanning is a lot better than Evernote's. And you're also able to scan multiple pages at once. And then once you're done, it will stitch it into a PDF, which is exactly what I just talked about doing. And these features make scanning much faster, but there is one other reason why I like ScanBot so much: the automatic upload feature. So within the app settings, you can actually choose a destination to which all new scans will be automatically uploaded. Moreover, you can choose a specific upload folder or notebook for most of these destinations. So in Evernote, I've set mine to a notebook called Inbox, which is also the place where I create most new text notes. And that brings me to the final point that I want to cover on digitization. And this is kind of verging onto computer file territory, but I do think it's good to cover here anyway. If you choose to upload your digitized files to your computer's native folder system instead of an app like Evernote, then it might be a good idea for you to create an inbox folder on your computer. And some people actually use a digital inbox folder just like a physical inbox. They save all new files to it, and then they relocate them later on when they have more time. Now, I don't do this for a couple of different reasons. One, most of my frequently accessed folders are pinned to my quick access sidebar, so opening them doesn't really take much time. And more importantly, number two, a lot of my work involves video editing, and video projects are full of references to footage, images, music, and tons of other files, and changing the file locations for all these assets can really break a project. So I don't mess with the inbox folder. However, using an inbox folder for your automatic scan uploads is a really good idea because it allows you to scan a document in seconds and then move on with your life. You really don't want to be standing around in the grocery store digging through Google Drive folders trying to find the exact right one for that receipt you just scanned. Instead, just sit down once a week and process the inbox folder just as you would do with a physical inbox. And this is exactly what I do with my inbox notebook in Evernote as well. And when you work this way, you efficiently batch all of your sorting tasks, removing as much friction as possible from the multiple times during the week where you might choose to make a scan, which means that you become more productive overall. And this is something that you want to be doing in every area of your life, looking for ways that you can make things that you do on a repeated basis more efficient. Not only will doing this save you time, but it's also a method of thinking in an adaptive way. And of course, the more time you spend thinking adaptively, the better you get at it and at solving the tough problems that you're going to be facing in your higher level classes and in your career. And if you're looking for more ways to improve your adaptive thinking, you should check out Brilliant. Brilliant is a learning platform built from the ground up for anyone who wants to become a more capable and creative problem solver. They have an in-depth library of over 50 courses that teach you math, science, and computer science in a way that focuses on active learning and hands-on challenges. And one course that you might want to start with, especially if you want to start thinking more naturally about how to make things more efficient, is their Computer Science Essentials course. This course doesn't require any coding knowledge beforehand, and in it, you learn how algorithms are designed and then improved again and again in order to be as efficient as possible. And since Brilliant focuses on well-curated sequences of problems aimed at getting you to actual mastery, it is a great complement to watching traditional educational videos. And if you want to get started right now, you can go over to brilliant.org/thomasfrank to start learning for free. Also, if you are one of the first 200 people to sign up with that link, you're going to get 20% off your annual premium subscription to boot. Big thanks, as always, to Brilliant for sponsoring this video and being a big supporter of my channel, and thank you to you as well for watching. If you enjoyed this video, you might want to give it a like and get subscribed right there if you want to see more on this channel in the future. Otherwise, you might want to click right there to get a free copy of my book on how to earn better grades. Lastly, you can click either here or here to get more videos on this channel right now, and you might want to check back next week or click right there to subscribe if you want to get that second video in my file organization series, which is going to be all about computer file organization. So I will see you in that next one.